Sorry,
so then you move your tripod.
Cedar Bark.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay, I didn't know that.
Oh, okay.
I mostly just know Mr. Professor.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
So this is like, he's just sort of changing because I get tweets, like I'm sort of aware of his, not all, generally, where is that?
I'm
and then he'll send in a poem about, like, dandelion.
So something.
Like, Renaissance.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And he's got
kids,
too.
Oh, yeah.
His partner, EJ. She's pretty cool. Too. Yeah. Just going I don't know him super well. It's just
Does he live in
Sacramento? Yeah, I'm pretty sure he does.
One of those guys would like to just sit down
and
see, like, what are you about, man? What's
up? He's definitely an interesting person. He's an interesting person at the class. But yeah,
cool. All right, good evening, everybody. Thanks for coming up to our climate change town hall. My name is John Levig. I'm a member of Parliament for Cloverdale Langley City. And we'll keep this evening fairly informal. I have a few slides that I'll run you through just to set the stage for the discussion, but it really is about hearing from you tonight. So I'll try to keep my talking fairly brief, and then we'll turn it over because what I want to do is get your thoughts on climate change. I've set aside about an hour for this evening. I don't know what your schedules allow. If we need to go after that, I'm available, but I don't want to hold anybody. If you have other commitments for the evening, this what I thought was going to be a lovely sunny evening, but is now a lovely sit-inside rainy evening. We'll work on winding up in about an hour, and we'll see where we're at that point. So to begin with, this is a series of town halls that we're doing across the country. Each of the members of Parliament have been asked to get out and talk to our constituents and to Canadians about issues that our government feels are important. And so climate change is one of the town halls we're doing. We've already had one on national defense and the role of national defense, future of national defense in Canada. And we're still gathering feedback, so if anybody's interested in that, I can get you some information after about the online survey for national defense, where we're looking at the role of the armed forces play in Canada, in North America, and internationally. Climate change is one. We did one last night in the city of Langley, and then tonight in this neighborhood. In early August, I'm going to be doing one on electoral reform. And I actually sit on the special interparliamentary, or the special committee that's studying electoral reform. I'm the Western and Northern Canada representative. And so we'll be talking to Canadians on August 7th at the Cloverdale Rec Centre about electoral reform. So if anybody's interested in that, let me know. We're going to be doing one this summer on Canada Post. And we wanted to make sure that the existing kind of labor dispute that was underway wasn't going to taint or overshadow that whole discussion. So I haven't scheduled a date for that. But we will be talking about the future of Canada Post, what Canadians' expectations are. And but with that as a preamble, we'll get into the climate change one for this evening. So from a Liberal government's perspective, we're about making evidence-based policies. And the evidence that we're seeing is that the climate change is here. You know, there are still some groups that are disputing whether or not it exists. But from our government's perspective, we feel that the evidence is supportive that climate change is happening. We know that global temperatures have risen. It's estimated to be about 0.85 degrees since 1885, since really the beginning of the Industrial Revolution. And in Canada, our temperatures in southern Canada we're seeing increases of about 1.6 degrees, and actually north of 60 in the up into the high Arctic. Already there have been measured increases of up to 2.2 degrees, which is very significant from a climate change perspective. And our government's feeling is that we need to act now. In fact, we probably should have acted a decade or two decades ago. So we're a little bit behind the eight ball on this one. The sense is that every year that passes is a year lost in actually trying to deal with this very important issue. And we feel that there's no time like today to be out there talking to Canadians, getting your ideas about this very important issue and how we can start addressing it. And by the way, you know, this is very informal, so if you have any questions, comments, thoughts, just, you know, we'll make it pretty free-flowing, so don't feel, don't be hesitant to interrupt us or interrupt me to add in any thoughts and questions that you have. In the fall, right, shortly after we formed government, the Paris Agreement happened. It was COP21 in Paris, an international agreement. There were 195 nations signed on to this, and really the essence of this agreement was negotiated in Paris, is that we're trying to limit global temperature rise to 2 degrees. And the sense is that if we go over 2 degrees, we get into that tipping point, we're going to see potentially catastrophic results. And so the agreement is to try to cap climate change, the increases in globally at 2 degrees. As I've said, in Canada's north, we're already seeing warming beyond that level. And so, you know, it really is important we try to bring the global temperature down as much as we can. And the kind of notional target is to actually cap the warming to 1.5 degrees. Some of the results, you know, like when we talk about climate change, it's like, well, you know, why should Canadians matter? I've heard people in January say, you know, when we get a cold winter's day, it's like, oh, I sure wish climate change was here, you know, it would make our lives a little bit better. Well, you know, that's not necessarily the effect of what climate change will be. We'll still have cold periods, we'll still have hot periods, but one of the effects is going to be extremes that you see. And so more extreme weather events, it could be, you know, in rain events and flooding. It can be things like longer and higher, hotter heat waves. There's a real concern, as I say, in the north with the warming that's already happening, losing our permafrost, losing the loss of Arctic ice, which can then lead to rising ocean levels. There are going to be, I was at a meeting earlier this week in Surrey, and you know, they're already working on modeling that if we see even modest increases in the ocean levels, things like the Nickelbeckel and Serpentine rivers could actually have ocean water coming in, and it could lead to the loss of a lot of our agricultural area right within our community. And so, you know, it's, you know, often talk about these things as being, you know, well, we won't have to worry about it, but there could be very real effects within our own community. And then things like threats to local food sources, particularly if changes results north of 60, and so the impacts that can have on our indigenous peoples in Canada. Where we're getting, really the root cause of climate change comes from greenhouse gas emissions. And it's a lot of, you know, the world's economy being driven by carbon-based fuel, fuels, the pumping of carbon into the atmosphere. And so this one gives a sense of where the various sources of where those emissions are coming from. I've heard figures that cities actually contribute up to about 60% of input into global warming factors. And it's things, you know, like manufacturing, like transportation, a range of those factors. And so when we talk this evening, I'd like to, you know, we'll talk a bit about, in cities in particular, what we can do to do our part to help address this really global issue. Can you guys see that? Or, you know, it says buildings 12%, agricultural 10%, waste and others. That's things like landfills that off-gas methane and other gases that add to global warming. Oil and gas sector 26%, electricity 11%. That's a lot of coal-fired power plants. And then transportation 23%, other industries 10%. So that's kind of the broad categorization of resources for greenhouse gases. In Canada, we're looking at trying to get to 30% below our 2005 levels by 2030. And this is in metatons of carbon dioxide being emitted. And so we're at kind of this point, and so we have a couple of projections here with where we could end up going as far as we don't start dealing with the emissions that are currently happening in Canada. And so as we see the economy grows, we see population grow. If we keep on going unchecked, you know, we're not going to meet the targets. And so one of the issues that our government is really working toward, and something I'd like to talk about this evening, is what we refer to as bending the curve. And so we're at this kind of juncture right now, and what we're trying to do is figure out what actions government and Canadians need to take to actually start moving this trajectory downward. And so we're trying to aim towards a 2020 target of 622 metatons, and by 2030, 524 units. And so really that's the challenge that we've set as a country, and we're working with the provinces to negotiate how we're actually going to do that. And part of the meetings that we're having across the country are to get ideas from Canadians, so when we get together with the provinces in October, we'll be able to take our ideas to the table from a federal perspective. So what's been happening, as I say, we had a meeting in November with the first ministers across the country. There was the Paris Agreement, which was ratified in with the United Nations in the spring, April 22nd, and the first ministers are going to be meeting in October of 2016. So really this is about gathering ideas to prepare for those meetings that the federal government can take when we meet with the first ministers. At the senior levels of government, there are four working groups that are being worked on right now. And so one is on mitigation. So how can we actually try to address the climate change, the contributing factors right now, or actually with the mitigation, it's looking at what's happening and how do we reduce impacts. Carbon pricing is one that is being looked at. Our government has said that we're not going to have one carbon pricing structure across the country, that the provinces will be able to deal with their own form of carbon pricing. It's a way of trying to create incentives for industry and Canadians to reduce their use of carbon-based fuels. Looking at adaptation and resilience, so how do we prepare to respond as society to changes? So like I was saying, with the Nicolmekl and Serpentine rivers, there are damming structures that are in existence. They're old, and so the city is already is looking at how do they upgrade those? How do we upgrade the diking systems? What else we need to do to prepare for kind of a worst case scenario? And then how do we actually start exploring clean technology, so non-carbon based energy sources, innovation, and how do we do all this without threatening or harming our economy? We want to keep Canadians working. And so we're looking at that kind of package and how do we do this in an economically wise way. For this evening, what I said, the ideas, Karen is going to capture some, Shirley from my office is going to be capturing some of the key points from the discussion, and we'll be sending those in to Catherine McKenna, the Minister for Environment and Climate Change. And they're gathering, input from across Canada, and Catherine will then be able to take those ideas when she meets with the first ministers in the fall. There's an interactive website, and if you have any thoughts after tonight that you want to add additional thoughts or comments, we can let you know how to do that. And then, the information will be shared with working group members. So for this evening, I'll give you a sense of where we're going to take the discussions. So there's four questions I'd like to explore, and then we'll go into each of them individually. I'll tell you, we tried it last night in Langley with just having a free-flowing discussion with everything up on the screen, and it was a bit hard to track on, and so I'm going to try tonight a slightly different approach, but if we flow from one topic into another, that's fine as well. It's going to be, like I say, pretty informal. But essentially, I'd like your thoughts on solutions to reducing greenhouse gases that you would like to see governments, businesses, and communities implement. And so if you've given any thought to this, if you have ideas what could be done to help us deal with the greenhouse gases that are being produced and put into the environment. Secondly, what are your ideas for growing the economy and jobs while reducing emissions? So if anybody has any thoughts on how we should be doing that so that we're not simply shutting down the country as we try to do our part as Canadians. The third question is going to be, how do we promote innovation and new technologies as we strive to reduce greenhouse gas emissions? And then the final one is, what can we do as Canadians to better adapt to the impacts of climate change and support affected communities, including indigenous communities. But I would say that it would also be coastal communities that we want to look at. And as I mentioned, there could be very real impacts on our own community right here if we don't deal with this. So does that sound like a plan? Everybody ready to jump in and share some thoughts?
Sounds reasonable.
Okay. So what I'm going to do, I'll just grab a chair.
Yes, please.
Vehicles like
cars on the road driving to work and
factors
that transportation for
common. You know, it's all of it. It's all of our vehicle use. It's trucks moving goods. It's people getting to work. It's that whole suite of transportation.
It basically is all transportation.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. So with that, yeah, like I said, I'll just grab a seat here. We'll keep it fairly informal. I'll just. Does anybody want to start on any thoughts on, and actually, do you mind giving me just your first name? Do a quick around the table so I know who's here. Sir, what's your name?
David.
David, nice to meet you.
Justine.
Rex.
Rex. Okay.
Alyssa.
Karen.
Yeah.
Okay.
Sheila.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. And then we have from my team. And Shirley in the back. And Christian. And Christian's recording so that if we need to go back on anything we might have missed, then we have a record of the discussion this evening. So, are you okay if I sit down? I just find that if I stand
down. It's late
in the day. Yeah. Perfect. So, you know, do you have any thoughts on reducing? You know, it could be in any of those sectors that we talked about. You know, your question about transportation, maybe that's a good one to start with. And I don't want to be leading in my questions, but I'll throw it out to you. Any thoughts you've had or questions that you'd like to share about solutions for reducing the greenhouse gases that you think that either we as government or as businesses, maybe it's how government encourages business to do things differently, or communities, how do we actually work with communities to deal with this issue of climate change?
Well, maybe for starters, with some low-hanging fruit.
Okay. Yeah, we love low-hanging
fruit. Let's start with the no-brainers. We have a major contributor to greenhouse gases in the form of our transportation, which relies on fossil fuels largely. In this province, there is a very modest grant that's provided for people who want to convert to electric vehicles, but it pales in comparison to what's being done in Ontario. So as one suggestion, I would encourage governments federally in discussion with the provinces, and the provinces to encourage a switch to electric vehicles as soon as possible.
You know, excellent point. And, you know, one of the things that I've heard, it's simply the supporting infrastructure isn't necessarily there. So there could be a financial incentive, but there could also be the, you know, helping build that the support infrastructure, charging stations, and
that as well.
Yeah.
Certainly.
Yeah. Okay. What other little hanging fruit do you have? Does anybody else have any obvious ideas that you think would be that we should be looking at?
Just maybe another is that we have a lot of land that's undergoing development here in Surrey. New housing is going in, and we have an opportunity here as a result, given a rapidly growing community, to think seriously about converting to much more energy efficient housing. Not just in terms of insulation, but in terms of energy creation. So why don't we see more emphasis on solar panels on roofs?
Right.
Geo-exchange,
right,
under all those sidewalks that surround all of those buildings, let alone under the buildings themselves and so forth. Now, in this area, I congratulate Surrey as one municipality that has developed a pilot program in the area where I live, which is the Clayton Heights area, where they're going to be permitting higher density development when you achieve certain levels of green in the plans for what you have. So I think we could do far more in this municipality and across the country. And getting outside the box of just thinking about more insulation and double pane glass,
right,
actually create energy with our structures.
I don't know if it's an idea that came up last night in Langley that I thought was very interesting. There was a gentleman there who just built a new house, and he said that in Langley City, and this might be a provincial building code, I didn't have a chance to look into it today, but in Langley City, they're required to put up trusses that are engineered to support solar panels on the roof. And so anybody building a land in the city has to meet that code requirement. And yet there's nobody that, I don't think I've seen a single solar panel in Langley City. And the comment was that the technology is too expensive for most people to actually install. And so, you know, again, it's preparing for that and looking at, you know, at some point knowing that technology will come down, some people will roll it out. So, you know, that there's a bit of visionary thinking there. It would just be nice enough to actually get the solar powers on the roofs of the new homes that are being built. Anybody else? Do you have, any, or, you know, I don't want to put anybody in the spot, but if there are thoughts.
Well, I mean, big black spot on Canada's environmental carbon is tar sands, and talking about dealing with climate change and not having the tar sands in that conversation is impossible. So, at least not expanding the tar sands, but the shutting down of tar sands and the creation of jobs for those workers is, I would say, number one on my list. And also, involved in that is the not allowing the Kinder Morgan pipeline to go through, and on the other side, Energy East.
Okay, so, and I think what I hear and that's buried in there, it's looking at our whole fuel source in Canada, what we're using for fuels, and how we get off of carbon.
Well, I mean, here we use hydro, right? So we're not using the oil here, but also considering the implication of selling it to other countries that are going to be burning oil there as well, so it might not, that might not affect us, but it affects the economy.
Related to that, one of the, I think, one of the interesting possibilities, and I think really exciting possibilities in terms of job creation in this country, is that, you know, so often one hears the criticism that if, you know, we're going to be cutting back on the fossil fuel sector, jobs will be lost. Frankly, the fossil fuel sector doesn't really employ that many workers. And alternative energy sources like wind and solar and so forth have shown themselves to be highly job creational. So there's an opportunity, I think, to think positively there. And just reflecting recently, too, on, you know, the skill set that many of the people in the oil industry have, for example, in Alberta with the drilling, is that skill set could be converted into work on geothermal. And Canada has huge geothermal reserves under the ground that can be tapped into. It involves drilling, similar technology, and so forth. And so the question becomes, why haven't we developed geothermal more than we have so far? And I think the federal government could play a real role there in terms of helping to set national vision.
Yeah, and, you know, and that becomes a key part of this, so that that leadership for a government to help explore new ways, new energy sources, I think is a key one that we'll definitely capture and give to the ministry.
Okay. I don't know what you're going to need this. Just wondering, how much research is put into that to make sure it is sustainable, to make sure that it is environmentally. Is it going to just replace carbon for something else that's going to ruin the planet down there? No, it will drill them down. So is there any research that's been done for that?
Sorry.
Yeah, I'm not an expert on this, and that's where, you know, it's about getting, because, you know, there's a wealth of experience in society, so if anybody has any experience here, you know, this is where we want to hear from you.
Well, there's two kinds of, if I can just start the conversation, and I don't profess to be an expert in this area, there's two kinds of energy that are available below the earth that we can tap into. One is called geo-exchange, that you can literally tap into on your property if you have some property that you own, or if the municipality has the vision to do it, you can tap into the geo exchange possibilities under sidewalks, under roadways, under parking lots, and so forth. What you're tapping into is the temperature difference between what's in the air and what's about 10 to 15 to 20 feet down.
But why are you going to sidewalks and sidewalks and looking for it?
Yeah, because yeah. There's basically available area there that must be done with other than us walking on it or parking our vehicles on it. So if you can tap into that temperature difference, and that's been done in no end of applications, and it's a well-recognized technology that's there, that just involves the difference in temperature between the air and what's under the ground, so that you can get cooling effects in the summer and warming effects in the winter.
And I think that, from what I understand, I've looked at this in building projects that I've been involved with, that in a lot of cases it's simply groundwater that's being taken out, and the either the heating or the cooling effect is being tapped into, and then the water is returned. So you're not adding chemicals, or it's just it's a circulation, and it seems to be.
So you don't actually have to even drill down.
No, you don't. In fact, it often involves excavation rather than the drilling. And you're simply, as I think as indicated by John, what you're doing is just circulating fluid like you would fluid in your refrigerator. You're circulating fluid into the ground and back up. And it provides, as I mentioned, it provides the possibility of cooling in the summer and warming in the winter.
So what's the other kind,
which is geothermal, involves tapping well down into the Earth's crust. You're not injecting anything in, like in the case of fracking with natural gas, you're not doing that. What you're doing is you're drilling well down and tapping into the very high temperatures that are below the surface of the Earth, and using a similar kind of technology to get that energy back up onto the surface. I don't know what the deepest would be, but my guess is you're talking about, in some cases, hundreds of feet, and maybe in some cases, 1,000 feet or more.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
Do we know how much does that hurt me in terms of the animals and the plants that people need?
I think it's minimal.
So the animals.
And it is being done extensively by many companies.
So the low animals lose their homes and the plants don't die for them?
No, because it's all underground, it's out of sight. All you see on the top end is presumably a relatively small structure that handles the circulation and so forth.
Isn't it the cost that's been prohibitive, though?
I don't believe so.
Because
many countries are doing it, but Canada has not.
We haven't. We looked at geothermal when we were building our home about 12 years ago and what put us off. So we were very interested in doing it. It's just flatly and simply how costly it was to do it.
Just on that, one of the local MPs from BC who just did a home renovation project, they installed geothermal, and I spoke to his wife, and she was like, "Wow, you know, they found it to be affordable and it's making a difference in energy use." So you know, I don't know if it's just simply you know things tend to come down over time.
I think so. Yeah.
It's, yeah. So.
And the more people who buy into it, the more the cost drops.
Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah.
Something, you know, transit comes up a lot here, and we know that, you know, the more cars we can get off the road, the better it is, and so that's another one that I'm hearing a lot of, particularly in our region south of the Fraser. Any thoughts on transit, you know, support for it? Right, yeah, you know, that seems to be, again, one of those low-hanging fruits. Let's get the transit infrastructure in place so we can take cars off, particularly from in the Surrey-Langley area.
Because I don't use transit because it takes almost as long to be in transit than in my car, and then I have to pay huge prices to park my car. So it's more convenient, even though I know it's not competitive. It's more convenient for me to take my car into Vancouver.
Right.
Than to use transit. But transit was better. I don't care about the price as much. I just think it should be a better, easier process.
Yes.
Hi, John. One of the things we forget about with the overall picture in the transit picture is the land use part. That's actually almost 50% of the picture. And I think if we can also concentrate on developing town centers or developing downtown's employment centers, where people, especially south of the Fraser, where if more of the head offices or businesses could actually find a way to locate here, there's all kinds of good reasons why they should. And I think our local transit actually would benefit from that, and perhaps it would be even more efficient, because then you wouldn't have to travel if your office to me or your work location might be in Vancouver.
So starting to already happen,
to a great extent, yeah, it is starting. It's taking a while, and I've been sort of familiar with this for a long time, but yeah, and I think that's part of the equation.
I heard, you know, the motto is good jobs close to home, and it's a way of as you say, developing those strong local communities so that we're not having to travel to downtown Vancouver.
So, you know, one of the things that they still haven't done is, you know, like in Campbell River or Campbell Park, down by 92nd, there's huge amounts of building going up there, lots of businesses, and yet they still don't have a proper system to get workers down there in and out of there easy. And they're doing more of those industrial parks here, and yet they still haven't really addressed that
very well. There's lots of great jobs in those industrial parks, too. Mm-hmm.
That's true with many industrial areas, and I hear your concerns, because I work in Abbotsford in town planning. I've worked in Surrey for many years, and do know that, yeah, that for whatever strange reason, seems to be almost the last place that you put transit. And it's a chicken and egg situation where, say, well, there just isn't the users right now, so we won't put in transit. And if you're working there, there's no transit. And sometimes I think there needs to be some just to actually put in transit service and, you know, link up these areas, I think, more effectively. And I think that's really what we need to be, you know, hammering on with at least the provincial government or the or TransLink, is to say, let's develop a better system for South Fraser where it's more interconnected. For instance, an LRT system that goes down Fraser Highway, but maybe also links up with Maple Ridge or with Walnut Grove, and then ties back into City Center by way of the Trans-Canada Route 4, make it a loop system. So we need to sort of develop that, I think, further.
Any other thoughts on this one, or I'll move on to the next topic for us to look at. Anybody have anything else on this one?
Yeah.
In regards to transit, I'm a university student, so I exclusively take transit. And I think that a lot of people my age choose to drive instead because of the price of a bus pass. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's the question of, am I going to spend $100 on gas, or am I going to spend it on transit when gas is easier for me to get around? So I think if that price was lowered, it would make a big difference for youth, and those will be the drivers for the next 20, 30 years.
Yeah, excellent point. Does the universities, wasn't there a program, or I don't know if it was the transit was included in the...
Well, you still have to pay for it.
Oh, do you? Okay. There's always a hook catch.
Yes, yeah, a slight discount, but also for people who are young who are not in university, who don't get the U-Pass,
right,
makes a difference.
Right, yeah, good.
John, just before you move on, and it actually relates to this topic here as well, there's a question on Facebook. It says, hi John, in order to implement many of the energy efficiency projects, there's a significant capital cost that can prevent companies from getting started. Has there been any discussions about financing solutions, and how would that be implemented?
Great question. I think that maybe we can bring that in, yeah, with when we talk here about the economy and so... Sorry, can you give me the question one more time?
Sure. In order to implement many of the energy efficiency projects, there's a significant capital cost,
right,
that prevent companies from getting started. And what are the discussions around financing solutions?
Okay. Yeah, and I think that, you know, that becomes a question when we talk about role of government and, you know, would Canadians support subsidies or investments in helping industry transition, or do Canadians feel that that's a role that industry should be playing, you know, kind of that leadership piece, and so I don't necessarily have a solution for it. It's more of a question to Canadians: what role do you see government playing as we make these, as investments are needed to make the transition from one energy source to another?
John, before we switch to the next topic, and actually picking up a bit on a question that was sent in by electronically. I just wanted to congratulate the federal government for what I perceive to be its position on the proposed new bridge to replace the Massey Tunnel, which, according to the mayors of the Lower Mainland, and frankly, I think the citizens at large, doesn't make sense as a major infrastructure investment piece. We much more need something like a new Patello Bridge, which is which is unsafe as it is, and it's far too small to be able to handle the traffic, and it has limited mass transit capability. So that's a huge investment, and it doesn't appear to serve any needs in terms of being able to move people, in terms of moving people around the Lower Mainland. And from what I can see, the federal government has not made a point of providing support for that financially, and it's moving its money in a direction that's more in the area of mass transit. So I congratulate you for that,
yes, and
if I understand properly.
Yeah, the commitment that we've made, specifically south of the Fraser, is up to half of the cost for expanding rapid transit, either through light rail or SkyTrain. And yeah, up to half, I think the dollar figure is about $750 million to invest in Surrey and Langley in that. That's where our money is earmarked to go into. So in this one, ideas for growing the economy and jobs while reducing emissions, and you know, this gets a bit into we were talking about with the question. I think, you know, it is a lead into it. What role do you see government playing? So, you know, do you want government to support economy and jobs through subsidies or tax incentives, or by just simply saying this is society's role and encouraging them through non-monetary means? You know, what are your thoughts on how do we play that kind of leadership role?
So I'm totally ignorant of all this. I came because my sister said, would you like to keep me company? So I'm probably going to say very ignorant things.
Yeah, well,
but, but for me, I kind of wonder, you know, how we started to recycle, and we started about 15 years ago, maybe even longer. That seems to have created a whole new industry. I'm just thinking, how that happened with recycling, would that not happen here too? Where a whole new industry would start to be created by us changing the way we do things?
Right. Yeah, absolutely. And, yeah, and I think, yeah, that there's that kind of opportunity, but and as we start getting into it, then yeah, it can start building this momentum. Something that came up last night in Langley, we talked about the leadership role that come from our community as Canadians, and to your point on things like tar sands and others, it's like, how do we actually get jobs created in innovation? And I'd love to see Canada be a leader where we can, you know, learn lessons here, but then take them to perhaps more populous nations and say, you know, here's how we can convert from one energy source to another or reduce impacts and create a whole industry, a whole economy, a clean energy, a clean tech kind of economy that creates jobs at home and benefits us internationally.
I think the federal government is probably going to have to offer some kind of incentives or some kind of tax breaks to get people to be able to get into it, because it costs you money to start things up. But it also may be able to encourage companies who are doing other things, research companies, to change the way they're doing things and start looking at more environmentally friendly, environmentally friendly way of doing things, so that they switch from something like doing tar sands, something that's more friendly to the earth. I think the government's going to have to get involved in that and do something like incentives or tax breaks.
Okay. Would there be general agreement from the group here tonight to see the government play that kind of leadership role? Or are you more about not having maybe industry play that role? Because there's any number of ways that we can do it, and
Just really briefly, John, I think maybe a little of both, because I think over time, sometimes it does take a governmental lead to entice businesses to do that type of research and development. And I think there's all kinds of opportunities. So I know our education systems, be it through engineering or agricultural innovation or even aerospace, are doing a lot of good things. And I think there needs to be more in the way of partnerships where perhaps it's a bit of carrot and stick, where there's some inducements provided to businesses to try to enhance their R&D component and innovate. So, and then perhaps the rewards would be, if you're innovating with products or procedures that reduce emissions or contribute to a sounder climate, then there may be a tax benefit attached to that. And if you're not, then I guess I do higher rates. So there might be some combination of things there.
Okay.
And just as a thought, I'm sure the federal government is always concerned about balancing books as best they can. So in terms of incentives, watching how that plays out. But as one suggestion, we have massive incentives that continue to be given to the fossil fuel sector. And that's a massive amount of money. And to help balance the books, my suggestion would be to come up with a plan to transition that kind of support away from the fossil fuel industry and put it into alternative clean energy.
Does anybody have any additional thoughts on this, or should I move on to the next? Let's move on, and if anybody hasn't had a chance yet to jump in and you'd like to, please feel free to do so. We're doing this fairly informally, so feel free to jump in with any thoughts or questions that you have. So the next area we'll explore, what are your ideas on promoting innovation, new technologies to reduce greenhouse gas emissions? And this could be role of government, again, industry. We've touched on this. There is some overlap in all of these topics. These are just sort of guidelines for the discussion.
More funding for universities, for research, things like that. Be trained, and also so that new research could be done on these things. Reduction and more funding even for elementary and high school so that these kinds of things can be taught.
So in investing in research and innovation. Yeah, excellent.
I think pilot projects that you were speaking about where you were, this gentleman you were speaking about, you do really small pilot projects that can be successful. I think it's a great idea really to change things.
Right. I've always been a great supporter of pilot projects, but it often seems that we fail to take the successes and roll it out to broader society. I've seen great pilot projects over the years that just kind of fizzle at the pilot project stage. And I look right now at the waste energy conversion that Surrey's doing to fuel their fleet of vehicles, where they're taking waste and putting it into the vehicles. It's just like, wow, why isn't every municipality doing that? Yeah, it's absolutely this whole biofuel plant that's
social media.
Right, yeah. It's really exciting what the leadership in Surrey is showing on that.
These pilot projects, they're being successful, they're falling apart. Expressing it, marketing it to the public.
Right.
So maybe we need to do a better job marketing it to the public.
Right. And I think to others who would be able to adapt it, so it could be to other municipalities, to other jurisdictions, other countries. Yeah, good. Suggestion.
I have a suggestion.
Sure, please.
Apologies if we've talked about this already, but something like that progressively increasing carbon tax, I think, would be great for all of Canada to implement. If you have a carbon tax for Canada and that goes up every year incrementally, you'll send a clear market signal to investors. And they'll be able to see that fossil fuels are going to become cheaper than, more expensive than clean energy.
And are you punishing the general public? I mean, that's basically how people out there generally see it. You can't. I don't think we should make change by making the general public feel that they're being. Because you know what happens with companies? We ran a company. This is what happens. When the companies get charged for something, it goes down to the end user.
Definitely.
I think that's what some of the problem is, the carbon tax is.
So what we've seen with the BC carbon tax, it actually rose. It started in 2008, and then it started at $15 per ton of CO2 emitted. And that was charged at the pump to people.
Because we all notice it.
Yes, and now we pay, so it went up to $30 in 2012 and it got frozen from there. Now we pay 7 cents per liter of gas.
This is how I feel about that tax. Yeah. I understand what it does, but I feel like that tax, I have
no choice but to pay it because I have to drive my car because we don't have any other way of getting around. And I think generally speaking, that's how most people feel the way what I just said as opposed to what you just said.
So then we have to find another way for us along with that. Let's find another way of getting around so that we have another option right now. We don't have another option because we have transportation, public transportation. So they have to work together to
use those taxes to put towards maybe the public transportation and infrastructure and stuff like that.
We're not using public transportation because it doesn't work for them.
Or then put incentives towards buying electric vehicles.
Yeah, or something like that. I'm just saying that we need to have
another.
With that, you have to have something along, along with it because I think that when it's presented as a punishment, most people psychologically don't work well with it. They like to be rewarded rather than punished, and so it has to work together. If that makes any sense.
I think just sort of this is a very interesting discussion because I think D.C. has been one of the first places to really institute a carbon tax, and others are picking up on it. It's done in Europe as well. But I think somehow, maybe through governmental support or a combination of government, innovative industries, et cetera, we have to sort of work with, I guess, the oil and gas industry or the carbon industry to say, well, perhaps there's ways of restreaming your business models so that if you are starting to put money, your profits into more research that is carbon neutral, and perhaps your taxes will be less, so there can be some other inducements. I think we have to always get to the source and start dealing with the auto producers as well as the oil and gas industry to try to get them to turn that corner and start producing more electric cars or more hybrids. And to find a way of equalizing the price. Ultimately, it would seem to me that right now we're paying a lot more for electric vehicles and hybrids because they're more expensive to produce. And that may also be a choice of the auto industry. I think talking large numbers, they switched the paradigm around and produced a lot more in the way of electric and hybrid vehicles.
That's right. I want to set us off on a different topic, and I will come back to the point you raised. But a really interesting point that I've heard made is that there are still jurisdictions, even in Canada, that produce their power through coal-fired power plants. And so, if you're using that energy source to power an electric vehicle, is there any net gain? And so it's sort of that dilemma, and so there's a whole bunch, we have to come at it from a whole bunch of areas. So I'm getting off of the coal-fired energy production and then moving more into the renewable sources, hydroelectricity and other things like that, but not every jurisdiction in Canada has hydroelectricity. So yeah, we're very fortunate in BC that we have that opportunity, and I think it makes great sense for us to really push forward with electric vehicles, but if you do that in some of these other jurisdictions, you could actually increase the amount of CO2 being produced because of where the energy source. So it's one of those sort of head scratchers. On the point on carbon taxes, it is very much a discussion that we're going to be having with the provinces. I had a discussion yesterday with a gentleman, and it gets back, I think you were talking about the carrot and stick, the incentive versus disincentive. And I think that's something we really need to strive to get right. The person I was talking to was commenting that although we've seen in BC since the carbon tax was introduced, the amount of it go up on the cost per liter, it's like, has it actually influenced our individual behavior? And many people said that the phrase where we don't have an option other than to drive. Then it's still you just sort of suck it up and you pay the extra, and so it's how do you build in the proper incentive as well to change behavior as opposed to simply being the penalty for having to rely on gas. And I think that's where as government as we move forward with this, it's like how do you get that right so that people are actually aware of the decisions they're making and where they're buying this versus that because of. But I think that I know that it really doesn't influence my decision because I have no choice other than to know, coming here tonight, I don't even know if I could get here by transit from where I live, and so I drove.
Yeah, definitely. I think that's when the issue of where the revenue goes to is very important. I would support the revenue going back to all of us equally. I think that's kind of the best way to distribute this revenue. And so,
you know, so are you saying, you know, because the current BC model ends up being like it's supposed to be revenue neutral, and so we get have lower tax, individual tax rates as a result of that? Is that how you'd like to see it?
I'd love to see it as a monthly dividend check to everybody. So psychologically, we see this money coming into our bank accounts. Yeah. So I definitely like to see that. I mean, that would protect people from, you know, especially lower income people. And it will still charge pollution where it should be. I mean, we need to charge pollution because that's what it is. And I don't think there's, I mean, you could discourage pollution in other ways through regulation or through education as well. But I feel like, I mean, we have the economy and we can, you know, establish prices, and it's such an elegant solution to be able to kind of transition away from fossil fuels and encourage people to change their behavior by pricing pollution. And for the BC carbon tax, from 2008 to 2012, fossil fuel use actually fell by 16%. And then it wasn't after that, and then, you know, it went up after that. But, you know, that's the kind of, you know, trend that I'd like to see.
So you're saying that the tax campaign actually made us stop using our cars as much by 16%?
It made us stop buying fuel by 16%, yes.
I have to say I'm impressed with that.
Yeah, you know what? The BC carbon tax is like a shining example in the world for something that's an effective policy for reducing fossil
fuels. But you know what bothers me is I, you know, every time a government or a municipality or city wants to do some kind of change, the only way they seem to know how to do it is to tax us. And I think that that's why we have people who don't have trust in their politicians, no matter what party they're from. And we have to learn how to do things differently.
Yeah, one of the points here, I think, in BC that I think results in some concerns on behalf of citizens like myself, and I think others in this room, around the carbon tax as it currently exists, is that it goes into general revenue. And the government claim that there's a revenue neutrality is not something that I think we are in a position to be able to measure. So to have to take it on faith. So revenue neutrality is one thing, but demonstrated, how should we say, neutrality for the individual is another. And so the notion of, for example, the check, while it may seem extreme or substantial in terms of a solution, maybe that's not the only solution, but maybe there's something there. But also in terms of making it more meaningful to people environmentally, could we have a system where there are assurances that it is going back into environmental matters, including, for example, even subsidizing purchasing electric vehicles?
You know, it's an interesting thing. I think the gas tax that the federal government collects, and initially they started doing transfers and initially the gas tax going back to municipalities was earmarked for environmental improvements, and so it was to help the municipalities make shifts. The municipalities, as I understand it, and this was actually at an environment committee that I sit on, Diane Watt spoke about having lobbied against that. They wanted it to go back as a sort of a blank check to municipalities that they could use for any infrastructure because of the infrastructure deficit that the municipalities carry. And so the government did change that transfer policy, and so now the gas tax that comes back to the municipalities no longer has that environmental requirement. It can go to anything. And I thought it was quite interesting because, you know, there had seemed to be a very clear connection between a pollution causing tax and making those improvements, and that's gone now. And I wonder if that's, you know, the right policy decision.
Yeah, I think definitely in terms of, you know, public perception, it's definitely a very, very kind of sensitive issue where the revenue goes to. And for me, if it's as simple and as easy to understand as possible, that would apply the best to the public.
Simple and well communicated, always great for policy. Well, with the time we have left, just a couple of minutes here, is are there any thoughts that you have on how we should be adapting to the impacts of climate change and supporting affected communities? So things that you think we should be investing in or supporting here at home? You know, would you be supportive of money here going to communities that may be even more impacted? You know, what's the right mix or approach for us as Canadians to support within our country and perhaps even internationally? You know, there's stories of some of the Pacific Islands that may no longer exist should the you know, the oceans rise even a small amount. And so, you know, what are your thoughts on this idea of adaptation and to the impacts of climate change?
So on more of a global scale, climate change, refugees, and the influx of refugees we're already seeing, and creating a plan to help people that are suffering from our use of carbon.
So being able to respond to these climate refugees, mm-hmm. as you say.
And even as part of that too, I think a big piece is just how do we make climate change a moral issue? Because mm-hmm. I think I'm very optimistic about the technical solutions. We've heard so many of them here; they're all there. But we don't have those enabling social conditions. So we can put in policy for stronger roof struts or things like this, and until we have that sort of those social conditions, I don't think we're going to change much. So that's where my passion lies, I guess. I'm very hopeful about the technical solutions. I'm a bit iffy about the kind of the social side of it, and to plug into this question, that's what I'm curious about, is how can we make climate change a moral issue, because people are dying and people are going to die, you know?
Education.
Yeah.
As an example, I volunteer a lot with the SBC, and one of the things I do is I go into the school and I do fight for it. The reason is to make kids more empathetic families. And I go into those schools and I see those kids have a different attitude towards animals and the relationships with animals that we didn't learn when we were kids. And so I know that these kids, when they're 20 or they're going to be my age, the way that they deal with animals and their relationship with animals is going to be very different. In 50 years, I know this, that we will think of animals totally different. And the reason that happened was because we started educating them when they were 5, 6, 7 years old. So if you think about when you were going to school, when I was going to school, about how what we thought about abortion, what we thought about women's rights, etc. I didn't necessarily learn that in my home. I learned it in school. And I think education from moral issues or ethical issues, moral and ethical issues have to start from education.
Keep going with that. Where would you go with climate change? How would you take those learnings and apply it?
Yeah. Well, then you have to go into all of this that we've discussed. It has to be within the education system. And it even just starts off like how the SBCA is doing it, or how volunteers go on it. I don't know. But it does have to start with those kids that are 4 or 6 years old, or it'll never be part of your fiber. Amnesty International group that we actually used to write letters, which we don't do anymore. But one of the things that the ladies in my group did, she would come to the classrooms, and this was in the high school, they had a program called Social Justice, and it talks about moral and ethical issues, and that's where people can go in with projects to go and talk to kids about how to change things or present moral issues to them. And those are usually not just issues that are just in Canada, they're issues that affect the whole world. So if you're really interested.
I've spoken at some social justice.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
But still, things are slow.
Things are so slow. And this is a successful climate change conversation. Now, what are we here? 10 people in a city of hundreds of thousands? This is good. And I wonder how can we up those? You know, because things aren't going
to
change.
We started with the conversation about recycling. And I tend to think of, my kids are still in school, and that's something that they learn. And, in grade one, they dealt with recycling, and that really is, it's part of their fiber. And, it's one of those other issues, how we take things like climate change and really ingrain that as values, just this is the way we live our lives in this society. So what are those messages that we need to take forward? I agree that youth and education are a huge part of it, and that will help us meet some of the targets for 2020 and 2030. But there's also people my age and a lot of us in this room, our various ages. We also need to be able to learn and embrace whatever it is that we need to do to make these changes.
Are there any ideas on the federal side that you're aware of initiating a substantial national campaign to increase awareness about climate change and to address the issue, the moral dimension of this issue, to create more support?
I don't know what the minister, as an example, for environment and climate change has on the horizon. I think part of it is seeing where these discussions go in October. I would hope that there would be an educational piece of whatever comes out of that to say, hey, Canadians, here's what we've agreed to as the federal government and the provinces and territories, and here's what you can do to help us. I spent my career in the public service working a lot on communications and getting messages out to Canadians about behaviors and things like that, and I see there's real value to that, and so I would hope that there won't be that kind of support, and I will definitely advocate just based on my experience.
Is there the indigenous communities? I know that there's a huge problem up north with the press of it's ridiculous how much their emissions cost. Is that part of the climate change? Because transportation costs so much, because oil costs so much, because the climate is changing, because things are harder to grow. Is that part of
cause and effect, but I think that our whole food supply system needs to be looked at. And when we have produce from South America being used to feed people in the north, I don't know. I know that there are discussions happening in Canada, even locally, about. It's like when we have the agricultural base that we have in the Lower Mainland, why are we importing so much food? And food waste is huge. And so I think the whole food system needs to be looked at and how we grow food, how we move it. And again, all of that can fit in. We looked at the transportation sector. Are there perhaps inroads that could be made there, reducing our greenhouse gases related to the movement of food in the country.
Yeah. And also supporting programs that you have to get the prices down for the groceries.
Right.
Because I think the electric is just ridiculous.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
There's an issue of losing ice roads in the north with the increasing temperatures. I was wondering if it's possible to unhook this question, unhook two parts of it.
We can do whatever we want, so if you'd like to unhook it, please do.
It talks about better adapting to the impacts of climate change, and then it talks about supporting affected communities, including indigenous communities. And I'd just like to suggest that another way of asking the question might be, and I'm sure you would have thought of something like this, is what can Canada do better to support indigenous communities in terms of not just mitigating climate change, but bringing an end to climate change. Not just in terms of mitigating the effects, but doing something positive about it. And I think of the many indigenous communities in British Columbia that are at the forefront of leadership in terms of raising issues around the Kinder Morgan pipeline, around issues of tar sands and the like. And in that sense, I think we can all do much more, including the federal government, to support the rights of indigenous people to raise those questions and to get honest responses, substantial responses to their concerns.
Exactly, which is supposedly implemented the United Nations Declaration of Rights of Indigenous Peoples, yet it's not going to be legally binding, which just seems like fluff on the surface. It's something that we're talking about, something very serious, but we're not going to implement a legally binding thing for that, right? So getting really serious about what that means and what that looks like, and not just using it as a talking point to make ourselves feel better. And what climate adaption looks like. Does climate adaption look like just surviving and providing with the same inequalities that we have right now? Or does it look like taking the threat of climate change and changing the way we live, changing the stronghold that corporations have on our country, and actually like implementing real change rather than just surviving in the way that we have now? Because if we get into thinking of days of like changing so that corporations are going to change the way they do things, well, if we just allow them to change the way they do things and continue, you know, to adapt to climate change, we continue the same practices, then we're just going to have the same sort of social issues that we have now. So looking at solutions from grassroots cities and stuff like that, like Vancouver doing their Greenest City Initiative and stuff like that, rather than looking at the national things.
I think, you know, that becomes the challenge as Canadians, how far are we willing to go in jumping into this to affect those kinds of really fundamental changes to how we live our lives, if we're really truly serious about this.
Well, the reality is it's going to be uncomfortable for a lot of people. There's no really getting around that. So it's not, there's not going to be any situation that you're going to make every Canadian happy that we're doing this, because it's going to be a change in lifestyle, but it's really a matter of survival for climate change. So it's not about making people feel comfortable. The government, I think, has to get over the idea of making people feel comfortable and start just doing the changes that need to be happening, right? Based on the science that the liberals keep talking about, we're based on science and like foreign policy and stuff. Well, those things actually have to happen rather than just talking about them, like the rejecting of pipelines and things like that, because we can't have pipelines and have climate adaptation.
So how fast do you want those things to happen?
10 years ago.
Yeah. Really, like, they should have happened.
Change has never happened like that throughout history.
No, it's never.
So why would you
The changes do happen quickly. Once you have the social pressure to put on them, things happen quickly. It's
yes,
just...
Because I've been looking at a lot of this, is what makes things change. Mm-hmm. And usually you have to get to a tipping point.
Yeah.
We're not at the tipping point for whatever reason.
Yeah.
I don't know why.
Because we're not at that tipping
point. We're not at the tipping point. And maybe it does have to be to do with what you said, is maybe government has to make changes and realize that those changes are going to happen more of an effect in the future rather than immediately. And so that has a lot to do with, to do with the fact that politicians have to realize that when they get elected, they're not looking at short-term goals, they have to look at long-term goals. And that's where the change really has to happen. So we have to stop looking at short-term goals. That's the tipping point when humanity can stop looking at short-term goals for our own immediate concerns and start looking to the future.
And looking at the bigger picture as well, because we talk so much about the economy, which is an important topic, but it's not the ultimate thing, because our survival doesn't depend on money. Our survival depends on the planet being here. So I don't know, I get frustrated as a young person continuing to talk about the economy and stuff like that. And like, for me, I'd rather have a planet than have this perfect economy that really right now is just reinforcing equality. So supporting an economy is a big thing for me.
One of the things that distinguishes our time, I think, from all previous human history, is that we are facing a climatic shift of such major proportions. I'm talking about human history and the results of human activity. We are in a situation where, and I think the large majority of scientific opinion is that we are in an era now where in the next 10 to 20 years, not 100 years down the road, we need to see major shifts in order to be able to protect the planet. There is no planet B. And part of, I think, the moral imperative for government is that it needs to be thinking about protecting its citizens. I mean, we are a country that's founded on security of the person in part in terms of our constitution. So in those terms, I think the government has a strong position to be able to take, a strong moral stance to help move us through this transition that we need to go through. And when we think about, I know one of the questions that was asked perhaps by your staff was that, can you think about the one major issue that exists now for the Langley Cloverdale area?
Right.
And you know, there's different ways to look at that. And I think in terms of old politics, one tended to look at it in terms of, well, let's see, where's a road that needs to be improved, or where do we need the next bridge, or what have you. But I think we're in an era of new politics where we have to think about the planet as a whole. And so when we think about protecting this space here, we need to think about protecting the atmosphere that's around us, that moves around the globe. And it's not just our atmosphere, it's everyone's. It's one planet, and if we can have politicians who can think in those terms, maybe we're going to be able to move in.
Yes.
Right.
Yeah, I was going to say, you're going to jump in.
Right, yeah. So I'm following your idea, actually, of making people feel comfortable. Because I was talking about this with my professor the other day. Think about how we got people to stop smoking. We made it scary. We told the truth about it. We weren't, you know, shy and bashful about it. And I think with climate change, there's a lot of emphasis on the positive, and people don't seem to be responding to that. And I think that being honest about, you know, the hard facts about what will happen if we continue to warm the planet, putting it on television where the average consumer is going to watch it, putting it at gas station pumps, putting it in places where it's actually going to be seen, would make a bigger difference than talking about all the things that we could do if we wanted to. So that's something that government could be a part of, potentially, as well as just the everyday person pressuring higher powers to put that into effect.
Anybody else? Mike, you're going to jump in.
Just a real brief comment on climate change and food security. With our climate changing the way it is, I think it poses concerns for the types of foods that we are able to grow. In some respects, a warmer climate here may bode very well for growing certain crops that we haven't been growing before. But in the bigger picture, we need to be very careful about what we are growing. I see right now that in BC, government, I think maybe with some federal support from the previous government, is wanting to sell, you know, a huge amount of blueberries to China. Well, that's great. It's good to have the, I mean, agroeconomics is important for this part of the world. But I think we need to be very careful about streaming things in a direction so that we are not just growing certain crops that are economically profitable, but I think we need to see longer term that we're you know, looking after ourselves in terms of growing a wider variety of things here that will support us longer term. And then sort of using that model to assist our brothers and sisters in First Nations communities or more remote communities around the country. There's all kinds of technical solutions that can be brought to bear that would work not only here but work elsewhere. So I think we need to sort of combine that and take a very serious look at climate change and food security and recognize the two go hand in hand.
We're just looking at the clock. We're a little bit beyond what I said we would be, so I'll just move to my last slide, which is simply a thank you. I really appreciate everybody coming out tonight for this kind of you know, first introductory talk on climate change, and I appreciate the, you know, the thoughts you've had. Like I say, this isn't the only opportunity, and I actually have to find my notes. If anybody's interested on adding any extra thoughts, I can give you the address. There's a also a hashtag to use for this. I really do appreciate you taking time out of your evening to come and join us and share some of your thoughts. And my brochure has our contact information. So if there's anything that you need from myself or my office, please get in touch. And if you have additional thoughts, you can also send them to me and I can relay those on to you.
I have one more thing.
Yeah,
I'm just wondering, when we're talking about how the number of people in this room, I was just wondering what kind of outreach the government's been doing about these town halls. Because I know this is their Facebook event page, and I think it's great that you put this on. But I wonder whether or not there could not be put more emphasis on letting people know that these are even happening, because most people that I've talked to, even within the community that I would consider, you know, people that are very aware of environmental issues and things, didn't know that it was happening. So that question of like, if we're, this is great, the whole democratic process and stuff, but if people don't know what's happening, they can't be participating in it. And I mean, right now we have a whole bunch of these town halls happening, and it would just be really nice if the government put a lot more effort into letting everybody know that it's happening so that they can participate.
Well, you know what, I'll throw that question over to Shirley and Christian, my team, who set this up for me. So did we advertise through traditional media?
No, we did door-to-door drops in local communities around. And we did include in the free listing in the newspapers.
Mm-hmm. Not necessarily just for this one, but for like
all the things.
Because I think there needs to be a bit more emphasis into like really creating like a, you guys should come out and talk about this. And I know that there is an attempt to do that, but I think there could be nationally a bit more effort put into that.
Yeah, well, I would say, you know, just I'll wear that criticism or feedback, you know, because it's positive. But each of the members of parliament who were being asked to do these, but it's left up to us to how we do it. And so, you know, with finite resources, we're using a lot of social media, and Christian helps with social media, so we're out on Twitter and Facebook. Newspaper advertising is expensive.
I know it's hard to get people out to things. It's just
But you know, they need to know about it so they can make the choice. If people aren't aware of it, then we're not going to get feedback. But you know, any suggestions from your networks about what's the best way to engage people? Like, this is all I'm first term and I'm learning as well how to get people out. You know, I'd love to have rooms full of hundreds of people that are having these conversations about. But I'm really happy with the audience we have this evening as a starting point, so I really do appreciate you coming out.
And Tom, let's face it, it's a tough time of year to be able to hold sessions, given that it's basically holiday time for all those families when the kids out of school.
Right.
That kind of
thing. I know, and that's a fair comment. I just find that everybody is so busy, there's never a good time of year to have conversations. We're all so busy going in so many directions.
Maybe to ask a question of you, would you be interested in perhaps coming out to meetings in our area dealing with environmental matters?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, and you know, it's everything from, you know, if you want to have some neighbors over, I'm more than happy to come to do those, or if there's things, you know, at school or whatever it is, you know, I'm keen to talk to our constituents, to Canadians about what I feel are very important issues. So my card, the brochure, has my contact information, so anytime, and it doesn't have to be just on these ones, if there's something that's of interest, give me a call, and if you have ideas about how to either get the word out or how to get people together to have these conversations, please let me know.
Okay.
And I could add on as well, this is the beginning of the conversation, not necessarily the end. The climate change consultations are going on until September, I think, something like that.
Over the summer.
Yeah. And the video will be posted online, so you can watch it back, or you can share with your friends and families and say, hey, I attended this great event, and encourage them to comment on it, either on John's website or his Facebook page or whatnot, because surely we'll be looking back and capturing all of the comments from everybody. There's also a website set up, canada.ca/, I'll post it later on, I can't remember it off the top of my head. But it is there as well. And the last thing I would say is, aside from liking and sharing these sorts of events when you see them online, actually have a conversation with even just one or two people that you know and say, hey, what do you know about this? And would you be open to taking a look at the video and sharing your comments and ideas as well? So we've got a couple of months left, and I'm sure the conversation doesn't even end there. So
the other question that I have is that, I want these to be meaningful. And so, this format, does that work for you? Does it meet what you expect for this evening? Were you expecting more opportunities to give me feedback? Were you expecting more opportunities for me to be, sharing with you? We're learning what this, how to do this effectively. So, any thoughts on the format for this evening and how we might be able to change it or improve?
One thought is just the capacity building potential that these gatherings have in learning. Me learning what you're doing and you're doing. Like, I would be curious just to know what people are doing, and that way we can kind of anchor our work locally as well, too. Not saying we have to do that now, but just something to think about. That when we come together, you're attracting probably a fairly engaged cohort here, and it's beneficial for us to know maybe what each other's doing.
Right.
Yeah.
Good.
Maybe to pick up on that, if the session is coming to a close, if people are interested in talking about what you're involved in, a lot of you are involved in interesting things. I'm involved in part of the movement as well, so if people want to share some thoughts on plug into each other. Right.
Oh, okay. I didn't hear what the movement was. I heard
hearing
out there. Okay.
Reaching out to community groups would have been an idea, to like, or, and schools and religious centers, and inviting groups to come and have a conversation. Perhaps maybe rather than just individuals, that might have created more of like an invitational sort of thing. Like, invite the general population, but then say, I really like, the sustainability group at Quatland.
Yeah, and I don't know if we reached out, but that's great feedback. I belong to the Green Timbers environmental group, and it's like, mm-hmm. I'm not sure that we invited them. And that's a group that is very, interested in environmental issues in our community. And so that's something where we can be more strategic in who we're reaching out. But then I guess the other thing is that I don't want it to be exclusive. It needs to be how do we inclusive to everybody. So even people that may have an alternate perspective on climate change, I think it's important to hear from them as well and to engage them in the conversation. So it's just about how do we bring in a diverse variety of perspectives, because that's how I think we'll engage more people, and that's good for all of us. Anyway, thank you so much for everybody for coming out, and I'll be around here for a few minutes if anybody wants to stay and talk and want to talk, or if you need to go and get on with your evening, then feel free. Don't open the door, don't feel locked in here. I really do appreciate you coming out, and hope that you found this video of some use.
Thank you.
I definitely
agree. Yeah. That's great.
Yeah, and if there are topics, like I say, that you'd like to see me bring to the neighborhood, just send me an email or give me a phone call.
I think it's really useful the way we did this. I mean, they stand up there and talk at us to very quickly move into engaging. Of course, I didn't think people would, but I was really quite impressed with the way people would. Yeah, well, I had the two of you to talk for me. And there's they're actually in your constituency, and so I'm trying to engage them. And I think that there's something to be said for what Christian said, which is to turn to a few people that you know and say to them, look, I'm going to this thing, come with me, rather than just coming on your own. That's how you increase the audience.
So neither me or Lena are really in the environment. Just came because of my sister.
You're told to.
The power of the
city. But they had something to say.
I don't know how educated they were, but there were some opinions in there, and they were a little probably different. And I saw
there's absolutely value to that.
We're too siloed. And if we're going to make any movement, we have to break down those silos and find those points of intersectionality where we learn from people.
Absolutely. 16% of
there was a lot of learning that went on.
What brings you here? What is your background?
I actually lobby for carbon pricing. I volunteered for a group called Citizens Climate Lobby. Oh. And we have a network in Canada, a huge network, 300 chapters, more than 300 chapters all over North America. And we talk to politicians and talk to the media and try to promote our politics.
Another topic, the Kinder Morgan pipeline expansion is having their public participation. That's the organization I work for, is advocacy around that. So if anyone would like information about that,
absolutely.
I have information about that.
I'm Kinder Morgan. And pipelines, what's really interesting is that when I was up door knocking, and I spent a lot of time in this neighborhood, I spent about 3 months going door to door here, and it's, I think, every neighborhood, or every door except for two gated communities at the time. And pipelines, I don't think, came up more than half a dozen times. It really wasn't a front of mind issue. And so it's been interesting now that we're getting into Kinder Morgan that's becoming much more, the deadlines are coming closer, and yet I'm still not hearing a whole lot about it.
The interesting thing is a lot of people don't even know really that it's happening. When you talk about pipelines, a lot of people are like, oh, the one in northern BC. No, the one that's coming right here, and people don't realize it's happening. I think there's just, for whatever reason, there's not a lot of information on it.
But it's not right now. I think mostly most people are against it.
Right, since you said you're involved in environmental, what sort of environmental things are you involved in?
Largely in connection with Kinder Morgan. Increasing awareness about that, working with First Nations communities. And I do work in association with PIPOC here in the Fraser Valley. Yeah, so that's a major focus. And you and I have gone back and forth by email some time ago.
Okay.
Where I'm the grandfather who wasn't planning on doing any of this, you know, when I retired. But became a grandfather, got the grandchildren, and you know, there's that talk about how can you look your grandchildren in the eye and say you did the right thing. So my wife and I have been motivated by the fact that we do have the grandchildren, let alone the kids. Not that it needs that, but it was just an added impetus to get us to say, well, look, time to commit and change the plans for retirement, so we're working more on this kind of thing. Because I think ultimately it's the most important thing that faces us all. And increasingly, and one thing that I could add is that I've only been involved in it for about the last 3 years, but in that time I've seen massive growth in terms of the number of people who are concerned and the kind of responses that we're getting when we talk about it. So it didn't come up much on the doorsteps as you went about, but John, I can assure you that it's there and it's been growing.
Okay.
So I'm very pleased about that.
Right.
There's definitely a lot of resistance.
I didn't get into it. To start with, my background, I actually spent my career working for Parks Canada, and so environmental issues have always been part of what I spent my entire adult working life dealing with. So this is near and dear to me, and it's great to hear from others who will also share some of those concerns. So, yeah, thank you for coming out this evening.
Anyone who wants to, this is an event happening next week in Surrey. The City of Surrey is putting out an implementation fund for their sustainability charters. It'll fund grassroots environmental climate change initiatives. Next week.
Sorry, it's funded by the city.
What's that? Why not?
Sorry,
Yeah. You're welcome to bring, we have open community tables there, so you're welcome to come and bring. Stuff related to the climate action. We're partnering with the city. This is the one. It's really serious.
Yeah, she was
my friend.
Yeah.